Welcome back to 60 Years of the Space Age, an ongoing internet video series exploring the history of the human presence in outer space in commemoration of the 60-year anniversary of the launch of Sputnik in 1957. Make sure to check out the last episode where we talked about Chief Russian Rocket Engineer Sergei Korolev. If Sergei Korolev was a shadow shrouded in mystery, then his counterpart on the opposite side of the battlefields of World War II, the German Wernher von Braun, was a giant covered in controversy. Born in 1912 into Prussian, that's the East German aristocracy, his family moved to Berlin after their original homeland was ceded to Poland due to the peace treaties of World War I. The second of three sons, Wernher von Braun was immensely fascinated by science fiction, taking Jules Verne's From Earth to the Moon as inspiration to shape his interest in space exploration. Today, we see rockets simply as machines used to get people and things into space, but a century ago, they were inventions undreamt of in any other era before. Rockets were seen as devices of immensely untapped potential, and the young von Braun, among others, were captivated by the romance of the open sky that they portrayed, although the darker side of such technologies had yet to have been revealed. He became a member of the German Society for Space Travel, the Verein für Raumschifffahrt, where von Braun and other visionaries like Willy Ley and Hermann Oberth lay the groundwork in launching early rockets of the liquid fuel type. They were mostly scientists and engineers, technical people gathered together to test some new technology known in German as the Rocket. But at the heart of the society were passionate enthusiasts driven towards a common goal, the popularization of rockets and their possible use in space travel, an idea still years ahead of its time. But for the VFR, their time had come. When the Nazis came to power, they pretty much shut down all civilian rocket societies. Such technologies they deemed a military priority instead. Regardless, von Braun and his close-knit team of scientists persisted with their work, getting in bed with the Nazis as a source of funding during the lead-up to World War II. Von Braun was given an opportunity to build rockets for the German army due to a loophole in the Treaty of Versailles that did not specify rockets under the list of banned weapons. The world's first long-range missiles were built by von Braun and his team under the supervision of General Dr. Walter Dornberger, who was also a man equally swept up by the dream of exploring space despite his military background as an artillery officer. Don't let the title of general deceive you, there's a doctor in there too. And just like Korolev, for a time it seemed like the sky was the limit for the team of German scientists as they rode their dreams of rocketry to horizons never before seen by humanity. Off the coast of the Baltic Sea at Peenemünde Army Research Center, von Braun and his team would build the world's first functional, not like my adulthood, liquid fuel rocket, marking the seaside town of Peenemünde as the birthplace of modern rocket science. Liquid fueled rockets generally give you more bang for your buck and allow you to control the flow of fuel that is burned to produce thrust. Controlling this thrust reaction and guiding the rocket to where it needs to go is pretty much the essence of rocket science, and the Peenemünde team did this with startling success with their prototype, the A4. Now this is when the mists of history begin to condense. Von Braun's rocket project belonged to the army at first, the German Heer, but as the Nazi regime consolidated power in the build-up to World War II, von Braun was advised to joining the SS, the Schutzstaffel, the paramilitary wing of the Nazi party. They were a group of ruthless thugs in jackboots, sworn loyalty unto death to Adolf Hitler. The relationship between von Braun and the Nazi party is difficult to understand. On one hand, you see a brilliant man fulfilling his patriotic duty to his homeland, while also pursuing his scientific ambitions. And there's nothing wrong with that. On the other hand, the Nazis did some fucked up shit. As the war dragged on, the SS made moves to dig its fingers deeper into the rocket program, and Adolf Hitler, seeking any desperate measure possible to turn the tide, christened the A4 as the V2, the Vergeltungswaffe 2, Vengeance Weapon 2. Since Nazi Germany could not win the war in the traditional sense on the battlefield, Hitler sought a game changer in the form of a Wunderwaffe, a never-before-seen superweapon. The V2 was one such weapon, the world's first ever intercontinental guided missile. The Vengeance weapons were built in a secret underground facility called Mittelwerk near the city of Nordhausen, using slave labor from Buchenwald concentration camp. The prisoners were put to work at gunpoint in the worst possible conditions imaginable. Thousands of the rocket factory workers died from execution, starvation, and disease. Reminds you a little of Sergei Korolev's story, except in this case, the boot was on the rocket maker's foot. It is ironic, then, that the instruments of humanity's planetary liberation were built under the conditions of enslavement. As a bystander to all of it was Wernher von Braun, who really couldn't do anything about it. He had dreamed of using rockets for space travel, not for killing people. Upon hearing news of the first casualties from London due to the V2 in 1944, von Braun was quoted to have said, "The rocket worked perfectly, except for landing on the wrong planet." Most people to have known von Braun accorded him as a good man, an honorable man that was put down a dark path because of the time period he lived in. As the death throes of the Nazi regime began in earnest in 1944, von Braun, who at the time held the rank of Sturmbannführer, or Major, was arrested and questioned for his loyalty, for having dared suggested that the rockets be used for space travel after the war, and not for the mass murder of civilians. Suffice to say that the V2 rocket program could not proceed without him, and with the help from General Dornberger, he was dropped of charges and put back to work. Seeing the imminent defeat of the Nazi regime, von Braun had to think of the future of his work. As British, Soviet, and American teams swept through the devastated German heartland in search of anything they could find on the V2, the scientists had to choose a captor among the soon-to-be victorious allies. But not just that, the Nazis were beginning to shoot their own people that would not fight to the death in the losing war. Der Krieg truly was verloren. It was time to leave Germany. As the entire country crumbled around them, the rocket scientists staged a daring escape using forged documents and simple subterfuge to bypass armed SS guards traveling across the country and into the custody of the 324th Infantry Regiment of the US Army at the end of the war in 1945. It would be a new phase of life for Wernher von Braun, one that would climax with an American walking on the moon. This has been 60 Years of the Space Age, an ongoing internet series chronicling the journey of mankind into space in commemoration of the launch of Sputnik in 1957. Thanks for watching, and I will see you in the next episode.